Many viewers and listeners may not be aware of the fact that Bart actually was a pastor before he was a professional academic. Right after he finished his studies in Germany, he went back to Switzerland, where he was from, and pastored a small church in Switzerland in a mining village. Could you share about that experience and how, no doubt, that initial time of reflection, even theologically, sermonically, shall we say, in that church context, shaped his theological reflections for the rest of his life?
Yeah. After Bart was a university student, he went to Geneva for 2 years, and he was an associate pastor or an assistant pastor in Geneva. He got an opportunity to preach there quite often. In fact, for of those 2 years, I think it was about 6 months that there was not a senior pastor there. The senior pastor left, and Bart kind of was the only pastor there. And he began to preach and worked very hard on his sermons. I think some of his sermons come out to be 16, 17 pages long. They're very long, actually, kind of surprisingly. He'd write them out word for word. He had a lot of interaction with the people there, interacted with some of the issues of poverty there. But after those 2 years, in which he had preached in Calvin's pulpit, and looking back, he would say that those sermons weren't very good and Calvin probably wouldn't approve of them. He moved to a small village in Soffenville in Switzerland and was a pastor there. And he was shaped by a number of things, certainly the day-to-day life of being a pastor. I think Bart struggled with that at times. He spent a lot of time in his study. When he left the pastorate, he apologized to his people for being so studious. But he saw the primary task of being a pastor as working on and writing the sermon week to week. That was very important to him. He became involved with the people of his village, and particularly with the worker movement and their conditions and their social conditions. And he was very involved in that. That's a well-known story as well. He was also shaped by and reacted against the declaration of war in 1914. He saw his former teachers as not being very helpful for that, even worse, supporting the war effort of Germany. And so all of those things came together in his life as a pastor, his day-to-day pastoral life, his social concern for the conditions of workers, his watching the events of the world. And a number of things happened. One of them was that Bart felt that the teaching he had received at the university really was not sufficient to provide him what he needed to preach each week. That comes up in a number of his writings as he reflects back on those years, that he did not feel that he really received an education that prepared him to preach week in and week out. That really drove him back to scripture. And we can see that in his commentary of 1919 on Romans, which is so famous. And I guess I could say the rest is history. I could talk more and more about that, but I don't need to. All that to say that from the very beginning, when Bart was thinking through some of these very key theological questions in his early career, those first 10 to 12 years were all thinking through those questions in a church context. He was thinking of them as a pastor, not as a university professor.
Now, he didn't even have an earned doctorate. It was all honorary doctorates, wasn't it? And I think that just blows one's mind, right? I mean, perhaps the greatest theologian of the 20th century and never had an earned doctorate, right? What are we doing?
Yeah, it is kind of remarkable. I mean, to think about, especially I think in German theology, where you not only do a doctorate, you do further study. Bart did none of that. He left after his university studies. He had worked for a journal there, but went immediately into ministry, and then in those 12 years was solely involved in ministry. He writes later in a very short piece where he's thinking back autobiographically that in Soffenville, it was the first time, he says, that I encountered the real problems of real people for the first time. I actually think that's an overstatement. If you look back, he's already dealing with some of these issues in Geneva. But there's no doubt that Bart is thinking through theological questions in a very concrete ministerial context. And he didn't earn a doctorate. That's right.
And while this isn't according to script in terms of the questions I had outlined for us, and we'll get to those as well, you know, people tend to think of Bart as someone who's just up in the clouds. but you've already alluded to it. He was connected to the people's concerns. He was called the Red Pastor in Sabinville, just concerned for how the laborers were being really oppressed, you know, just not accounted for well, how he took issue with Harnack and others with the Kaiser War Manifesto. Mm-hmm. I mean, that shows that he was grounded in many respects. He wasn't, you know, even though we think of him so often as this ivory tower theologian, he always was connected, right? I mean, and he would go to prisons to preach to prisoners. There's something to be said there for how theology is to be done, in my estimation. And yeah. What are your thoughts about that, Kimlin?
No, that's true. And preaching to prisoners comes at the end of his life. And there's a very famous, if people want to read it, there are translated a number of those sermons in a book called Deliverance to the Captives. That's one collection where you can read Bart's sermons to prisoners. And that is very remarkable. I think that people do sometimes think that Bart is just a purely academic theologian or that he has no real connection to the church. But he made a decision very early on. In fact, it wasn't even really a decision. He writes a letter to his friend, who's also a pastor, Ternazan. And he's received a lot of pressure, particularly from all sorts of people, many of them who are involved in the socialist movement, to leave the church and to become primarily someone involved in a political or economic movement. And Bart says, and writes Ternason, and says, not for one minute, regardless of our criticisms of the church, did I ever think of leaving it. Bart thinks there is no other place to go. He doesn't think that there's a higher ground on which to stand from the church by which to view the problems of the world. And that's something he reiterates not only in that letter, but in other places. Bart simply does not think that one can think of Christian existence apart from church existence. They are deeply interwoven from him. So that's one quick thing about that. Please. Bart can be very critical of the church. That's true, particularly in the Romans commentary and in some of his early writings. But that criticism is always coming from a place really of love for the church, and he never leaves it.
When you think of Martin Luther King Jr., and they had opportunity to meet during Bart's one visit to the States, right? You know, King himself said that unless there's, you know, a great love, you can't have great disappointment, or great disappointment, there's no great love. And so I think for Bart, it was a great love and a great concern, a great disappointment. It wasn't critic for critic's sake. It was someone who wanted to be a part of the change and wasn't taking shots from the gallery, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And so, and we'll no doubt have time to come to that later in our discussion about, for Bart, Christ and theology and church are all interwoven. You don't separate them, even in the concern for the world. And boy, do we need that today. So that being said, let's go further into reflecting on what you're doing in your book and thinking through what you've already said about